Good morning, everybody. I'll stand over here by our student section, which sat in the front, by the way. That was very, very good. We would like to welcome you guys to University of Arkansas at Rich Mountain. We're so happy to have you on our campus. My name is Chad Fielding. I'm the Vice Chancellor for Student Affairs here, and we are excited to have this opportunity to have one of my alma maters. She's from Henderson State University, so I was excited to see her this morning. But Quality of Life received a grant from the Division of Arkansas Heritage, and in partnership with Rich Mountain and really Brenda, let me just give credit where credit is due, because Brenda puts these events on from start to finish, and she does a fantastic job with all those. So when I say in partnership with UARM and Brenda Minor, that is exactly what I mean. And so we are happy to have you guys on campus today. We're looking forward to a great presentation. And I'm going to, Bethany Hughes is going to come up here from Quality of Life, and she's actually going to introduce our speaker. So thank you guys for being here today.
Dr. Mary Beth Trubitt is an archaeologist for the Arkansas Archaeological Survey and a research professor in the Department of Anthropology at the University of Arkansas. She earned her PhD in anthropology from Northwestern University in 1996 and then came to Arkansas in 2000. She heads a surveys research station at Henderson State University in Arkadelphia, where she teaches, conducts research, and works with the members of the public interested in Arkansas history and archaeology. Trubitt's most recent book, Two Caddo Mound Sites in Arkansas, was published in 2021, by the Arkansas Archaeological Survey. And I'm pleased to introduce her to speak to. I know this is going to be super exciting and entertaining, and y'all just pay attention and enjoy. Thank you so much for coming.
Testing. Are you hearing me? All right. Welcome. I am happy to be here in Mena. We're going to talk about Caddo history in the Ouachita Mountains. So, first of all, who was here? Who was here before the Americans settled Arkansas in the early 1800s? If we look at a map of Arkansas at AD 1700, it would look something like this, with the Caddos living in southwestern Arkansas, the Tunica and Caroa living in the southeastern part of our state, the Quapaw living near the confluence of the Arkansas River and the Mississippi River, and the Osage had their main towns on the Missouri River, but used much of northern Arkansas as hunting territories. So here in Polk County, the Indians who were here were Caddos. It's later on, it's after 1700, that we see other groups moving in from east of the Mississippi River, like the Cherokee, the Shawnee, the Choctaw, came in later. But these are the indigenous people of Arkansas. And how do we learn about Caddo history here in Arkansas, Caddo history in the Ouachita Mountains? We have a couple of different sources of information. We can look, of course, at written records, text sources. We can look at oral history. And we can look at archaeology. And it's actually best if we use all these different sources in conjunction, if we look at all of these together. Because each of these sources of information about the past have their pluses and minuses. So, for example, if we look at written records, texts, maps, we have descriptions of Caddo Indian communities left by Spanish missionaries and French traders, beginning really in the 1500s, but especially dating to the late 1600s and early 1700s. So here we have a 1719 map by Jeremy Delisle of Louisiana. And it shows several place names that are recognizable to us today. Based on Spanish and French descriptions, There were several different Caddo communities living in what is now southwestern Arkansas, northwestern Louisiana, east Texas, and southeast Oklahoma. Now we have the Capodacho, the Natchitoches, the Hasinai, and the Kahibio. These were related groups, but they had some cultural differences. They spoke different dialects of the Caddo language. They each had distinct polities, and they each were made up of numerous different communities. There was actually no overarching political system that was the Caddo until more recently, until the 1800s. So before European contact, there were several different regional groupings that shared cultural practices and shared a language, but had some differences as well. So we have written descriptions. Then we can look at oral history. Now the Caddos continue to relate their oral history through the language, through the Caddo language. An example of this comes from the Caddo turkey dance. This is a traditional dance that's performed still today. The words in the songs in the Caddo language that accompany the turkey dance talk about specific past battles and can be tied to historical events that occurred in the century before the Louisiana Purchase. So in performing these songs and dances, the Caddos continue to maintain their language and their heritage, but they also continue to relate this oral history generation to generation to generation. And then we have archaeology. Archaeology is a third source of information we can use about the past. And you know, with archaeology, we can get back centuries, we can get back thousands of years. Archaeologists study the material traces of past human activities. We look at the places where people lived to learn about their history, to learn what they made, what they ate, where they lived, how they worshiped, how their relationships were with their neighbors. And we're interested in all these aspects of human behavior, but we're looking at it from the material traces that people left on the landscape. Now, I'm an archaeologist, so I tend to focus on this as a source of information about history in the Ouachita Mountains, but I realize that there are other sources as well, and there are advantages and disadvantages. So if we can work written records, oral history, and archaeology together, we get a much deeper understanding of the past. Now, this is a chronology based mainly on archaeology. Again, this is my bias, I'm an archaeologist. We have a history here that goes back at least 14,000 years, and archaeologists have broken up this long time period into a series of periods named by archaeologists before me, the past generations of archaeologists. The important thing to remember is that there are some real cultural changes that occurred over the past 14,000 years that we can document. We can look at these changes that go on. We can ask questions about what went on and why. Why do people change their way of life? Why not just stay the same? Why change? So archaeologists ask questions. We're always asking research questions. When did this happen? Why did it happen? What occurred? What changed to make this occur? Why did people take up this change? You know, just because people know about neighbors who are farmers doesn't mean that they themselves are going to become farmers. May not work for them, may not be the most optimal choice for their lives. So you know, why do people do things? when did people first arrive in North America? Well, if you ask a lot of Native Americans, they'll say, we've always been here. There's no coming, we were always here. So again, we have different sources of information, and each of these sources tends to have pluses and minuses. There are biases with each. And again, I'm an archaeologist, I have my perspective here as well. In order to answer questions about the past, archaeologists need to not just find stuff, find artifacts. We want to document the relationships between things. We want to understand the relationships between things, where things are found, what is found with what. It's this information that allows us to make interpretations about the past. So I'm going to take you through an outline of history here in the Ouachita Mountains. Some 14,000 years of history here in the Ouachita Mountains. Just to give you a sense of what we find here and what the interesting questions are that we can ask. So the earliest physical evidence that archaeologists have for people living in this area comes in the form of chipped stone tools, chipped stone points that would have tipped spears or darts used for hunting, left by small groups of people living here at the end of the Pleistocene. The Pleistocene or Ice Age hunters would have been hunting animals, many of which are now extinct. So animals like mammoth and mastodon, which we don't have around here anymore. There have been occasional finds of mastodon bones here in Arkansas, but we have to go a little further afield to find examples of mastodon bones with humanly made tools in direct association with bones of now extinct Pleistocene animals. We have to actually go to Missouri to find the nearest case. But we do have the evidence of the chipstone spear points here. Small populations moving across the landscape, mainly hunting, based on what we know from the archaeological evidence. By about 8500 BC, Indians were making these what we call Dalton style dart points, and hunting not mastodon anymore, but deer. Mastodons and other Pleistocene megafauna have gone extinct, and the animals that are hunted in 8500 BC are the same kinds of animals we hunt now. This week it's hunting season. So people living at this point in time are adjusting to some major climate changes as we shift from the Pleistocene to the Holocene. And not only is climate changing, but the suites of plants and animals that live in these areas here are changing as well. My colleague, Roger Coleman, Forest Service archaeologist, excavated at a site in Pike County a couple of years back where he documented Dalton style dart points that were deeply buried below later archaic styles of dart points. He was interested in looking at people's responses to environmental changes and also looking at interpreting how people were using this location for hunting and also for retooling, creating new points. Now, during the long time period that the archaeologists call the archaic period, people living here took advantage of local resources. There are plenty of local resources here, plants and animals to use for food, stone to use for tools. people during this time period settled down into stable communities, traded with their neighbors. By the end of this archaic period, what we call archaic period, people were building barns. They were cultivating domesticated crops. So there are some major changes that occur during this, 7,000 year time period, 6,500 year time period. As people are kind of settling into the Ouachita Mountains. By about 6,000 BC, the river systems had stabilized. People are increasingly settling down next to the Ouachita and the Caddo and the Little Missouri rivers in the floodplains. I did excavations at a site near Hot Springs some years ago. The site's on the Ouachita River. And it had good evidence of this settling down next to the Ouachita River. So among the artifacts that we found were things that pointed to how people got their food. So we found certain styles, new styles of dark ones, chip stone dark ones used for hunting. We also found these notched pebbles that were used as fishnet weights, so people are fishing with nets. We found quantities of burned hickory nuts. Hickory nuts, good source of protein, good source of oils and fats. Nowadays, we want to get away from fats, but in the past, people wanted fat. Fat is good. So hickory nuts were processed in large quantities, mass quantities, and we found burned hickory nut that we could date to 6,000 to 4,300 calibrated BC. During this time, people used indirect methods of cooking. So this is before pottery was invented. People are doing a lot of cooking using something like pit barbecue kind. So you dig a hole, you put some rock in there to hold the heat of the fire, build a fire. The rock holds the heat. Then when the fire dies down, you can lay in your food, and then it'll just kind of slow cook for a day. And then dig it out and eat your food. Well, then you get these scatters of fire-cracked, burned rock. The rock is just a byproduct of this cooking method. But to archaeologists, it tells us we're right near the cooking area. We're at the place where people were cooking. The archaic period is also the time period when people were intensively quarrying navaculite from the Ouachita Mountains. Navaculite is a rock. It's now used as Arkansas whetstone. Same thing, but back in the past, it was used for all the chipstone tools that you needed a sharp edge for. So navaculite outcrops on the ridges of the Ouachita Mountains, especially around Hot Springs, and there were numerous ridgetop quarries where Indians in the past quarried this rock for toolstone. One of these quarries is in Polk County. It was identified and mapped and tested during a project in 1993 as the Arkansas Archaeological Society training program in archaeology. The team created a map of the site. They identified boulders that had been battered. They identified clusters of flakes and stones left as from hammering those boulders, and they identified large quantities of navaculite debris, quarry debris. The byproducts of this toolstone quarry activity. Remember, what's left behind was the stuff that people didn't take with them. What people took with them off the quarry site was the good quality navaculite that they took back to their residential sites and mapped into into a variety of scope tools. And as it turns out, there are archaic forms of archaic period styles of tools, dart points, and other artifacts that are found as far away as Louisiana and Mississippi, made out of Novaculite from the Washington Mountains. As part of our Arkansas Novaculite website, we've been able to document the movement, not only the quarry sites themselves in the mountains, but how Novaculite used for stone tools was carried away from the Ouachita Mountains and traded to neighboring groups living as far away as Louisiana and Mississippi. Polk County was not an isolated place in the past. The river valleys were major arteries for trade and interaction. And people moved around the landscape. They moved goods around the landscape. And we as archaeologists can trace the movement of people and ideas beyond this region by looking at the distribution of the artifacts themselves. Now, by the end of the archaic period, the beginning of what archaeologists call the woodland period, we see some technological changes. We have the appearance of pottery. Pottery is invented and becomes in widespread use. We have a change from spears and dart points thrown tools to bow and arrow during this time period. And we see changes in food ways as well. People increase their domestication of food crops, plant crops. There are some important changes in this domestication process. And a lot of this is better known from sites in central Arkansas and in northern Arkansas, in the Ozarks. But we've got more and more information about woodland period farming from sites in the Ouachita Mountains as well. Many people don't know, but archaeologists look at the invention of domestication of plants as something that occurred in something like seven places around the world originally and then spread from there. Well, the Mississippi River Valley and Arkansas, what is now Arkansas, was one of those seven primary locations of the invention of plant domestication. And it goes something like this. Beginning about 4,000 years ago, we see people in this area begin to cultivate and domesticate a variety of small-seeded plants that are nutritious for their seeds. They're either oily seeds like sunflower or starchy seeds like goosefoot. Goosefoot is better known nowadays as quinoa. But there was a local version of that was domesticated here in Arkansas, has since gone extinct. Now we get our quinoa from South America. So we have a whole suite of these small-seeded plants that were domesticated and grown here as crops during the woodland period. This was before we get the introduction of the tropical cultures, maize or corn. And beans. Corn was initially domesticated in Mexico and gets into this area by way of the Southwest. But by the time we find corn here, around 900 AD or so, people have already been farming for some 2,000, 3,000 years for a long time. So it gets me. Arkansas is the natural state, right? Well, I don't think so. I think it should be called the farming state because people have been farming here for some 4,000 years. That's impressive. So I did excavations in conjunction with Ouachita National Forest at a site called Drag Over that's near Mount Ida in Montgomery County. And one of our main research questions had to do with what were people eating and when did people first start domesticating plants for food in the Ouachita Mountains. We had evidence at this site for people living here during the Archaic period, during the Woodland period, during the Mississippian period. And much of the evidence that we found, food-wise evidence that we found, related to activity during the Mississippian period. But our botanical specialist, Leslie Bush, identified a little charred bit of squash or gourd that was burned, preserved because it was burned. And we were able to get a radiocarbon date on that little fragment to AD 825, which is late in the Woodland period. So that's one of our early examples of plant domestication in Ouachita Mountains before 1000 AD. We know much more about the Mississippian period, which around here we call the Caddo period. The ancestral Caddo Indians lived across a large area. This map shows the extent of the Caddo homeland. And we're talking about southwestern Arkansas, northwestern Louisiana, east Texas, southeastern Oklahoma. So people lived across a large area. And the Ouachita Mountains is actually a significant part of this area, located between the Red River Valley to the south and the Arkansas River Valley to the north. Caddo people here during this time period were farmers. They grew corn and squash and beans and a variety of other crops. They hunted, they fished, they collected wild plants for food as well. Nuts are still important. Hickory nuts, pecans, still an important part of the diet. They lived in stable settled communities along the major floodplains of the Caddo and the Little Missouri and the Ouachita Rivers. Based on descriptions left by later on by Spanish and by French, the Caddos had households that were made up of several related families, and kin groups were ranked in terms of social status. There was a social ranking between kin groups. The Caddos built mounds, they buried their dead in cemeteries, often accompanied by beautifully decorated pots. The Caddos were very sophisticated. They were a significant factor. They had major influence on the region as a whole prior to European colonization. Caddo communities interacted with each other across this region. They traded materials, including salt. The Arkansas Archaeology Month poster for this year featured salt and salt making. And recently, the Arkansas Archaeological Society training programs in archaeology that take place in every June have focused excavations on a Caddo salt making site near Queen called Nakukuidish. The location was one where people could take saline water out of a slough and evaporate it, heat it and evaporate it, and boil it in order to process it for salt. Salt's been a desired commodity around the world for a long time. People like salt in their food, and it was a key trade item here. Caddo society was hierarchical. There were inherited religious and political leaders in these positions. The community leader or the chief was called a caddy. The religious leader was called the shinisi. And each community would have a temple or religious building set on a mound where important rituals would take place. There were also residences, houses for the political and religious leaders. The community itself would be spread out. It would be dispersed. There were farmsteads scattered along the river valley to take advantage of good farming. Everyone wasn't living all together in town. They were spread out. Our work at Dragover near Mount Ida in Ouachita National Forest had to do with looking at cultural identity. And we were interested in looking at community relations with neighboring communities to the north in the Arkansas River Valley and to the south in the Red River Valley. In one of the areas, we uncovered a series of post stains, the soil stains left by digging a hole for a post. We had a pattern, circular pattern of a post that measured 7 meters in diameter that was the foundation of a house that was here in the early to mid 1400s AD. We have very few structure plans from non-mound sites in this area, so this example is significant. Also at the site, we found a large trash-filled pit. Well, trash, what are you gonna get from trash? As it turns out, we're able to reconstruct a lot of our information about foodways from this pit because there was mussel shell in there, there was lots of animal bone in there, there were charred plant bits in there, including corn, burned corn cupules that dated to 1500 AD. This particular feature is the main deposit that gives us information about the late phase of activity in the Ouachita Mountains. We found a similar trash-filled pit in a different area that dated to the mid-1600s. So it is clear to us that the Caddo community here at this location continued here after the Spanish expedition of Hernandez de Soto came through the Ouachita Mountains. There were a series of encounters with foreigners that transformed Caddo life here in the historic period. And this really begins with the Spanish De Soto expedition. Came through Arkansas and Texas in 1541 to 1543. The De Soto expedition had a big influence on native communities here in Arkansas. But here in the Ouachita Mountains, there doesn't seem to be a population exodus or population plummet that we see elsewhere. Instead, Caddo communities continued through the 1600s. But by 1700, AD 1700, local families had moved out. There's really a dispersal of population. Most people probably moved south to Caddo communities near the Red River, joining these Caddo communities there, joining relatives in these communities there. In part, pushed by aggression from Osage to the north and increasingly from people coming in into Arkansas from east of the Mississippi River, but also drawn by trading opportunities with the French down in the River Valley. In the late 1600s and the early 1700s, the Spanish came into this area intent on missionizing. They were interested in bringing Christianity. The French were interested in trading, and the French set up trading posts. The French were interested in the crops that the Indians had. They were interested in salt. They were interested in buffalo hides. They were interested in acquiring horses. The Caddos were interested in getting French guns. They were wanting to get cloth, beads, metal tools. So for both the French and the Caddo, this was a mutually beneficial relationship for a time. Excavations near Texarkana have established the Roseboro Lake site as the location of La Harpe's 1719 Nesson Post, located near the Catamanacho community of Minnesota. Of this time period, Caddo historian Cecile Elkins Carter writes, and I quote, "French-Spanish rivalry over borders had benefited rather than bothered the Hacinai, Catamanacho, and Natchitoches tribes. Long before either the French or the Spanish took up residence in these tribes' territory, the Caddies had practiced the art of trading for things that they could not manufacture or produce, and they had protected their borders by making allies of their nearest neighbor." End quote. So during the 1700s, the impacts were population decreases because of introduced diseases that people here did not have resistance to, didn't have antibodies to resist to, and disruption from newcomers, people coming into the area. But the major impact for Caddos here was felt after the Louisiana Purchase in 1803. There's a real shift in focus. The Americans weren't particularly interested in primarily in missionizing or in trading. They were interested primarily in land for settlement. They wanted land for settlement. They wanted the native people off. So even before the Indian Removal Act of 1830, groups like the Cherokee were coming into Arkansas, pushed from further east, and it was affecting conditions for the people who are indigenous to what is now Arkansas. In an 1818 treaty with the United States, the Quapaw ceded millions of acres between the Red River Valley and the Arkansas River Valley in what is now Arkansas. In an 1835 treaty, the Caddos ceded land in Arkansas and Louisiana to the United States. And after that, the Caddos left their homeland. They moved into Texas. There, they were caught up in the Texas revolt against Mexico, Texas move for independence, Texas statehood. They had land set aside for them in the Brazos River area, but a series of crop failures made hunger a real issue. And there were a series of attacks on the Caddo there by white settlers there in Texas. This really forced their move. And in 1859, the Caddo community and communities in Texas moved into Indian territory. It was then Indian territory, now Oklahoma. There in Indian territory, initially the Caddos had a reservation with the Ouachita. They established farmsteads on the frontier and attempted to reestablish their way of life. But as a result of the 1887 Dawes-Lockman Act, parcels of reservation land were allotted to individual Caddo families. And large amounts of so-called surplus land was sold off by the U.S. government to non-Native settlers. This is also the time of the Oklahoma land rush. And by 1902, the Caddos were forced to allot their land, and the reservation itself was eradicated. This is also the time period that saw the greatest pressure on Caddos and other Native people to assimilate. This is the period of time when we have boarding schools, when we have children taken away from reservations, away from their families, and put into boarding schools where the conditions were abysmal, where the you know, it was a military boot camp type structure. These are kids. Kids were punished for speaking their languages. It was a clear attempt at assimilation. The awful conditions in these schools, in part, led to reforms in the early 20th century, including legislation like the 1934 Indian Reorganization Act. In 1938, the Caddo established their own elected tribal council and began reestablishing tribal government with a semblance of sovereignty. Nowadays, the Tribal Center for the Caddo Nation of Oklahoma is in Binger, which is in western Oklahoma. The Caddo have persevered. The Caddo are still here. The population is now something around 7,000 people. Most live in Oklahoma. They're living their culture. They're interested in their history. Some enjoy coming back to their homelands, including here in Arkansas. This picture was taken at the Caddo Conference in 2015 in Arkadelphia at Henderson. This is one opportunity that archaeologists like me have to talk face to face with Caddo people. And as an archaeologist who researches Caddo history, this is an important opportunity for me to consult with members of the Caddo Nation, members of the Caddo Nation of Oklahoma administration, including their Tribal Historic Preservation Officer. I'm interested in finding out what Caddo would like to learn about their history using archaeology. And I also want to learn from them. And the Caddo Conference is one opportunity for this. The Caddo Conference is going to be, the next one's in spring of 2024, and it will be again in Arkansas. It rotates between Arkansas, Louisiana, Texas, and Oklahoma. And 2024 is Arkansas. It will be, the plans are developing now, but we're planning on having it at Historic Washington State Park. Caddos continue their cultural traditions into the 21st century through art, through music, through language, through community. Caddo artists work in many different media today. They market their artwork on the internet. They market their artwork through jury shows. For example, Geraldine Redcorn is a famous Caddo potter who recreates ancient designs in her pottery. And she has pieces on exhibit in museums across the country. There are younger artists working now, like Chad and Chase Earls. Many different artists working, making a living at art. There are several groups working to revive the Caddo language, teaching language to to children, teaching language to adults, preserving Caddo songs, creating new songs. So Caddo continued their cultural traditions through face-to-face interaction, through Facebook as well. There's a lot of history here in the Ouachita Mountains. The Caddos were once a populous society. They lived across large areas of southwest Arkansas, northwest Louisiana, east Texas, southeastern Oklahoma. They had a sophisticated and complex society. They were influential in this region prior to European colonization and American settlement forced them off their lands. Nowadays, the Caddo Nation of Oklahoma is relatively small, but the Caddo people are still here. They are still living Caddo culture. I put up here some resources that you might be interested in if you want to learn some more. There's a lot of information out there on the web. Some of it good, some of it bad, so I'm trying to put up there some good stuff. And I am open to answering questions, any questions that you may have as well. Well, they came most directly across the Mississippi River. So, but there were Cherokees who came over before the Trail of Tears,
yes,
that were here decades before that. And there were Cherokee settlements up in the Arkansas River Valley. So yeah, they came from, originally from North Carolina, but from southeast across the Mississippi River. Yes, there are a number of different tribal groups that came through Arkansas. There are multiple Trails of Tears if we look at that time period in the 1830s and 40s. Yeah?
I have a student who couldn't be here today, but he wanted me to ask, what would you say was the most historical impact the Caddo people had on surrounding tribes?
The Caddo were known as diplomats. They certainly knew how to conduct warfare, but one of the things that we see is that Caddo sites, unlike in several other areas in Arkansas, we don't have palisaded villages. We don't have stockaded villages with fortification walls like we see at the same time up in the northeastern part of the state. So the Caddo were able to maintain relationships with the neighboring tribes before European contact and continued that after contact as well. They attempted to work with the Spanish and the French who were coming into their territory. They attempted diplomacy as much as they could. So that's probably one of the major influences.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Are they considered part of the Algonquin Nations?
No, that's a separate language group. There, we can look at different linguistic groups, different language groups here in North America. And the Caddo speak Caddo, which is a Caddoan language, along with Ouachita, but a distinct group from Algonquin speakers and Sioux speakers. There are a lot of different language families. Linguists identify a lot of distinct language families that are different. With languages different from one another as English and Chinese, there were a lot of distinct languages spoken here, a lot of distinct Indian societies that lived here in North America. Not just one culture, lots of different cultures.
Thank you.
Yes.
Just a couple of questions.
Sure.
The first one about language being, I've tried to look up a lot of place names and things, mm-hmm. and just vocabulary lists, grammar, etc., about the language online. Where do you find your sources? Because I've only found a few sources that have like five words.
Well, you know, now the Caddo Nation of Oklahoma has a language specialist who is employed by the tribe. So she would be my first contact because that's her job. So yeah, and she's actually she got her position because she's been very active in language Caddo language workshops for a number of years. So she's an expert.
The second question is about the burial mounds. I know in Louisiana, the current chief has his background in helping repatriate the mounds there.
Mm-hmm.
Are there any initiatives to repatriate the mounds in Arkansas? I noticed you wrote a paper about two mounds in Arkansas. Do you know if you're trying to, you know, like have some of that acreage to, or have an alliance with a archaeology group with the acreage?
Right. So there, of course, has been federal legislation to repatriate funerary items from burial grounds. But what you're talking about is acquiring the land itself. Some of these mounds are in, you know, on national, federal property, or on tribal property, or on state property, and those are protected because they're on public land. But many of these sites are on private property. And we have strong feelings in our country about private property. What you can do and can't do on your own land. So it's a bit of an issue. There is an organization called the Archaeological Conservancy that works like the Nature Conservancy and buys up property in order to preserve it, conserve it, protect it. And there are examples of Indian nations buying mound sites here in North America as well in order to protect them from development. I don't have a good example for the Caddo specifically. But I know the Quapaw purchased land. Many landowners do want to be considerate of the history of their property. You know, landowners know their property intimately and are interested in its history and keeping that history intact. So many people reach out to me in order to contact the Caddo and see what they should do or shouldn't do or can do. We do have burial protection laws here in the state. That is, you know, you can't knowingly disturb a grave, marked or unmarked. But many of these mounds were not primarily burial mounds either. Many of them were structure mounds. They enclosed layers of burned buildings, important buildings. But you know, preserving these historic places is an important thing. And it's an important thing for all of us. Our history, my history here, is relatively recent, but it's important for all of us. Other questions? Yeah.
The way I understand it, at some point the Iroquois in the Northeast made a big push and pushed the smaller tribes such as the Delaware down into this area and then integrated with the Caddo and the Cherokee. Can you tell me a timeline on about when that was?
Well, the European exploration and settlement on the coasts began a series of effects, impacts that were felt by Native nations across the country. People in the interior were buffered from that time-wise. I originally come from Massachusetts, and the timeline there, very early on, there is a population drops, plummets because of disease, because of conflict. And you have movements of people as one group acquires guns and starts attacking neighbors, and people competing for land and resources and trading opportunities and so on. So the timeline differs depending on where you are in the country. In terms of major movements of people across Arkansas, our state, the main century for that is the main centuries are the 1700s and the early 1800s. If we're talking about the main impacts of having people from different native societies forced together, I guess, then we're talking about the late 1800s and the boarding school period. One of the effects of the boarding school period is that people, children growing up in these boarding schools met people who were from different Indian nations than them. And so in the 20th century, you have a lot of marriages that are between Caddo and someone in a different Native nation, Caddo and non-Native, and that's relatively recent. Yeah, it's a long time, right? Yeah. When you think about it, GMO, genetically modified organism, plant domestication is genetically modifying those organisms, those plants. So in that sense, we've been eating genetically modified food for some time around here, actually. But in terms of Caddo Nation and Indian nations, and modern agricultural and modern ranching practices, this was part of the assimilation efforts by the federal government in the early 1800s, and yet in the modern era, tribal nations have often been left out of, say, the big federal omnibus farm bills that get passed every 4 years or something like that. And there are efforts nowadays to change that. As a matter of fact, the University of Arkansas has a department that is specifically aimed at food sustainability. And indigenous food sustainability, and working on legislation with tribal partners to improve food conditions, improve diet conditions in Native communities. So I recommend looking at that. Go to the University of Arkansas website. It's an interesting program. And they have lots of information about this.
purpose behind all of this, all of their vision?
The purpose behind this region? Explain that a little more. What?
The investigation.
This investigation?
Yeah.
You know, I'm interested in history. I'm interested in what people did before and how people lived in the past. I realize that I'm not the first one on, you know, to live in my house, but certainly on my land. I see that there are generations that lived there before me. I can see that in the plants. I can see that in the architecture there. So for me, it's, you know, I'm interested in the past. I would like to think that knowledge about the past helps us move forward to a better future. I would like to think that knowing the history of our country, good and bad, helps us to move ahead and get together as Americans in the future. You know, Native Americans are not just part of history, they are here in the 21st century as well. They have triumphs and problems that they're addressing in their communities, some of which have to do with in this history. So, you know, I think part of the importance is to acknowledge the past and work to make things better for the future. The boarding school period is one example. So Native people know about this history. Many non-Native people don't, and it was just in the last couple years that we started to see news stories about unmarked graves in unmarked cemeteries next to these boarding schools. And media accounts of this brought this history back again and brought it to more people's awareness. Native people have been dealing with this history for decades. How are you going to be a good mother if you didn't grow up with your mother? If you grew up separated from your parents, how do you learn how to be a good mother? So these historical events have repercussions that continue today, and we can ignore them, but that's not going to help. So oftentimes I look at an artifact and say, well, that looks like it is middle archaic style. Styles change through time. We know that. They do now. They did that too. And so we have changing styles through time. But we also have radiocarbon dating. So we can't necessarily date the stone tool, but we can date a piece of corn that was next to the stone tool on the floor of a house, for example, and use that association to give the stone tool an age. So we have a combination of techniques. Well, there were lots of sites that were inundated by reservoir construction around here. Lake Ouachita inundated a number of sites, but Ayer was one of them. And Ayer was a there at the site. And one of my slides, I had a picture from the 1939 project. It was like colored pencil drawing of the mound showing the different layers of buildings there. The mound actually wasn't a burial mound, it was a structure mound. And it had at least 9 layers of burned buildings, one on top of the other. It was a way of ritually closing off the location and cleansing it for reconstruction. So in 1939, the University of Arkansas Museum supervised a WPA crew excavating at that site. They produced a short report, but it was never fully reported. There were 3 other WPA excavations in the state that were more fully reported in published literature, but that one not so much. And the material is still there in the museum there in Fayetteville, curated by the museum. But there's limited information out there about that particular one. But that was the most important location. And it was just not too far from the Drag River site. So it was the nearest town center for the people living at Drag River. So that's why I've been interested in it lately. Yeah.
What was your most significant discovery?
Oh, you know, I think, I always get excited about the project I'm working on and then the next project that's coming along. So I was woke up this morning and thinking about neutron activation analysis, because that's the thing I'm working on this week. And it's like whatever the most recent thing is, oh yeah, that's the coolest. I get excited about things like architecture. So if I can find the traces of a floor that's burned clay that is the floor of a building, or burned wall posts that show me exactly where the entryway of that building was, and I can picture it in my head how it looked in the past. That gets me excited, because I kind of like architecture. But next week might be something else, because we're looking at something else. There's no physical museum anymore. That was shut down maybe 15 years ago. But all the collections are still there. There's still a curator. They've been working on digitizing collections so that you can look at things on the web. So there is, take a look at the University of Arkansas Museum website, because they do have some material, kind of a virtual exhibit sort of thing. Especially handy if you can't just go up there. Yeah.
How did Novakai affect the living styles of the Indians in the Ouachita Mountains? And is there Novakai that is being used today, if there are examples?
Yes. Yes, there is. So I pronounce it Novaculite, but it is now used for whetstone art. And, a lot of people don't sharpen their knives anymore. That's okay. There is still a whetstone industry. A friend of mine has a whetstone company, and he markets his whetstone all across the world. He's got people coming from Germany to visit the plant, the quarries, because they're buying. A lot of times now it's specialty whetstone. And Novaculite is also used for it's used for gravel, it's used in paint. There's a lot of modern industrial applications of it. In the past, it was very influential because if you're making all your sharp-edged tools out of stone, you need access to good quality stone. And not everyone has enough rock. You don't know this here, because Ouachita Mountains. Ouachita Mountains, there's plenty of rock. But if you get down into the Gulf Coastal Plain, there's not as much rock. And so where you don't have good sources of raw material, you need an evacuator.
I think that's probably about our last question. If you do have any other questions, you can definitely contact Brenda, because she has contact information. But we definitely want to thank Dr. Trubitt for coming today, and we appreciate it. Yeah, and so on your tables, for us to continue to be able to have these type of presentations and speakers, if you guys will just complete this short survey for us, we'll leave them on the table. And if you'll leave them on the table, we will collect them. But we would definitely appreciate